Please give the evaluation sheet to the presenter so they can receive your immediate feedback. And also we have a sign-up sheet. I don't know where that goes.
It's over here.
It's over there. Okay, so we have an evaluation sheet. I will have it over there. So everybody feel free to move inside here. So sorry you get all these things. So we are going to start. So this is our wonderful presenters today. And we are talking about reaching zero attrition.
Good morning, everybody, and I thank you all very, very much for attending. Our title is Reaching Zero Attrition Through Dynamic Assessment. We have both the challenge and our suggested solution. We are aware that we are making a claim, and we like to articulate this claim. Our okay. I have a soft voice. And I thought I would, yeah. So it's very important to articulate the claim that we are making because it's a big claim. If we strategically apply this novel of method of dynamic assessment, particularly with at-risk students, we can reach zero attrition rate. The premise is that every student at DLOI is really capable of reaching a higher ILR-based level. If we provide individualized, personalized dynamic assessment sessions, this has to be periodically, because that's really the stipulation for it to work. Methodically, as well as strategically. And strategically means that the management has to be involved. The background, Stelza Anna will elaborate a bit.
The background, in 2016, we actually designed and implemented a workshop, a 40 hours workshop, to push students for a higher level, which is 2+2+2, meeting the plan, the DLI plan at that time. So later, in 2017, we actually started to adjust this based on the objective and the urgent need for helping at-risk students to overcome their weaknesses. So we adjusted the workshop for meeting that objective. Also, an initiative from our associate dean at that time, Captain Anderson, based on that, we did the program. The mentorship program was launched at that time, and also an SOP to serve at-risk students was published, and also a school certificate at that time for the mentoring. We attempted. So we attempted to create cadre of mentors to help at-risk students at that time based on the mentorship program, or to serve in the mentorship program. So we trained teachers in that workshop. We trained teachers on the skills that require them to help the at-risk student using dynamic assessment, and we teach them all the skills needed for that. We piloted the mentorship program in one department, and then to all other departments in UMC. And we trained, the number that we trained till now reached 57 teachers from all MSA, Levantine, and Egyptian dialect. And unfortunately, we lose 20 of them because of the two departments move out of the school. But they're not getting away. They're still here, DLI, in the Arabic school. So Then now we have a lot of experience all through these 3 years. Individual case studies, successful stories. Here, because of the time, we're going to share one experience with you. And however, our objective is to present dynamic assessment as a methodology, how we experienced it, and also a most effective teaching methodology and a remedy, and also as well as profoundly operative intervention strategy. So our goal is to present it, this method, hoping it will be thought-provoking and helpful, informative, and beneficial. So you might like it, just see it, and you will tell it at the end how it works or not working.
Yeah, this is a very important point in this presentation because we really like to introduce to you this dynamic assessment method and how effective it was in our experience. So this is our outline. We'll go over them very quickly. We'll just address attrition through a story, a case study, and then we'll define our definition of dynamic assessment. And we'll talk briefly about the program. And the most important is really the outcome because it sets the guidelines for the road ahead, actually. And then we'll end with the conclusion. So the attrition, I like to start by asking all of you to please take about 10, 15 seconds to think about these questions because they are integral part of the presentation. I hate the lecture and I wanted to make it interactive as much as possible. So we'll give you about 10 seconds. So the case study of Omar, and by the way, Omar is a fictitious name that we gave it to him. It wasn't even his Arabic name that originated just to hide his personal information. So Omar is an at-risk student. He's a student of modern standard Arabic, and he was recycled twice due to consistent failing in listening skill. He is above average in reading skill and passing grade in school. He needed help, remedy, especially to overcome his listening skill or challenge. Omar has been to all specialists, including academic specialists, and all road diagnostic reports, recommendations, and submission strategies, and some gave some tutoring. So all tried to help, but no progress was made. That's why he was recycled twice. So Omar's listening grade continued falling, creating him possible third recycle. My question is, what do you think he must have failed? We have some citation from his feedback, part of his feedback. Maybe transcribe it. It's very important to focus on the affect components in dynamic assessment. That's why we work with this. So our perspective in the attrition discussion, which is really our answer to the question we just gave you, is this. Help that was provided to Omar by specialists was mostly diagnostics. And I'm talking especially about the DA specialists. It reflects a need for an effective remedy. A reliable, valid, effective intervention strategy that has the method, teaching method, especially for design for at-risk student is urgently needed. And this strategy, because this is from our perspective as trainers, must be transformable, which means that we can teach it to both students and staff. And that's what our offer is, and that's our little contribution. We offer dynamic assessment. And we develop a method, we call it ADMA method, assess, diagnose, mediate, assess. If we have enough time, we'll go over it in detail, as we rehearsed earlier, we don't have time for it. But it will be part of the presentation that will be in Sakai, accessible to everyone. So now back to Omar. My first appointment with him, this is just to let you know about the process in which we address dynamic assessment. We start by educating ourselves about the student, reading his portfolio, which in our school we put the 5 diagnostic forms in it. So who is really Omar? Again, the focus also on the affect components, which means the motivation, the attitude, and so forth. So he has notable high level of will and motivation. You can find out this from his portfolio also, that has a lot of data and a lot of information can be used. Personality type shown 9 out of 10, introvert preferences, with low speaking skill. So I'm asking you if you think there is any correlation between this. We know there is correlation between listening skill and speaking. However, in my experience, I found that the extreme introvert usually they don't speak. May have high ability to learn, and the evidence is high grade in reading skill. And like I said, his past history, he has a master's degree. He's married with 2 children, and his interest in good reading. We like just to give you an idea, again we took the name out and we don't have access now to the portfolio. Okay. Oh, you have to get out? That's okay. Because of the time we have to skip. So in the diagnostic, I just wanted to show the E and L because it's kind of, it has a lot of information, and they, as you all know, it's not exact science, and we have to convey this to the student that this is not exact science. It's only ijtihadat, which means attempts. His visual preference to process information, also usually I find some correlation between the reading and the visual, the high visual. So after all this information, I met him at 9, and I have some prognosis or some idea about his. So the first hour was all about self-awareness, to let the student know about all the diagnostic forms, about his personality, and the most likely. And we have to use this language because, like I said, it's not really science. And the second hour was to assess his ZAG and ZPG, which is what he can do, and accordingly, once we identify what he can do, we know the ZPG. So that was the results that I needed to start working with him. And the third hour, right away, we started dynamic assessment. 6 weeks passed. Of course, dynamic assessment was every day and exceeding sometimes 1 hour, like to 2 hours. Omar grade jumped from C minus to C plus in ICPT 301. And most of you in MSA know about how difficult 301 is. I just like to share with you how happy he was with this improvement. And here come the GLPT. Of course, 302, he also made progress. Just for the time, we wanted to So here Omar managed to overcome his challenge and reach his goal and graduated, and we felt that fit company. But central to his success, as he and myself agree, was dynamic assessment. So this is the moral of the story. And so dynamic assessment did not only offer Omar learning strategy and technique, but scaffolding and sincere moral and psychological support, which, like I said, is main component of dynamic assessment as a method. I don't know if I can still go here or not. Yeah, it looks promising. This is a form that we developed to get feedback from the students about how effective the method is, and also about the techniques and the strategies that we use. And I just wanted to highlight that part if we can. I found his, like I said, he's very highly educated and very articulate, and I liked his feedback about the method, and at some point we'll share his suggestion also on how effective and how it should be done. Okay. I like just to stress that point he made. I often imagine if I had started, because this is really a familiar theme with most of the students that we work with, especially either post-GLPT or late in third semester. And also it underlined the importance of starting with the student, at-risk student, as early as possible, as part of the strategy that we are suggesting. So Omar's story is only a sample of how effective and tens of success stories we have documented over 3 years, and mostly it's individual teacher working, of course, who are trained on this, whoever is applying dynamic assessment. And we managed to document them all, and hopefully we can publish them soon in a paper that we are about to finish. So now, what is dynamic assessment? Ustaza, I'm not going to elaborate.
So from what we heard about Omar, we kind of just trying to give you a quick idea what is dynamic assessment. And in terms of definition, probably everybody here or most of you know, and why we chose this method and how it works. So in order to understand what is dynamic assessment, there is two ways. The first one is to compare with static testing, which is a static assessment. The other one is to, from the history overview in terms of function and objective of the method. So static testing, as everybody knows, it's just assessing the current performance level of the students, and also does not predict or reveal any educational need for the students. And also the goal is just to assess. So at the certain time or a time frame. So the dynamic assessment, on the other hand, it's reveal new emerging cognitive ability. And also this learning ability may serve to as a predictor of the student's educational need. So how we do it? So the goal is to assess, then diagnose, intervene, and then offer the strategy and mediate this in order to get to the outcome that we need. It aims as well to help students to be an independent learner. A certain point, you can leave the students because you already developed this kind of cognitive ability. So a certain point, you can leave the student to work by himself whenever you feel he's ready or she's ready. So sometimes you don't need to continue to build the DLPT. So what is dynamic assessment? From the history overview, and considerable literature starting from Vygotsky, most of you heard of him, Feuerstein and Diaz, they're all prove the validity of this concept. Let's go a little bit.
Oh, you wanna go back?
Yeah, I'm happy. So these two people, Vygotsky and Feuerstein, worked on the method with children. Mm-hmm. Okay. So Lantolf and Matthew Poynter pioneered the use of dynamic assessment with adult learner in the foreign language teaching. So we actually like this book so much. Everybody, if you wanted to educate yourself, this is Matthew Poynter's book about dynamic assessment and how he applied it to adult learner of foreign language.
By the way, it's $175.
Yeah, it's worth it. So when we say we took it from here, we developed the concept and we use it with our student here at DLI as also an adult learner for foreign language of Arabic. This is some definitions from these resources, from the literature, which is stressing on the assessment is dynamic assessment procedure of assessing and promoting learning development. And James Lantolf as well, there is no difference, but I'll try to show you the whole procedure is assessment and instructions, and how we get to the development of learning is through the mediation, through the interaction, which is already Vygotsky mentioned it from the beginning, and he worked with children. So, this is what we see as a practitioner and trainer. We develop this definition as we see it. It's a procedure and a process where both assessment and instruction in the same time take place with the objective of developing the cognitive ability of the learner. How? By the mediation. So the mediation is what assessment plus instruction, what makes the, it makes by the mediation or through the mediation. So this is also a mediation. I'm not going to spend time on it because of the fit of the time. So it's important that the mediator will help the student reach the answer with persistent sessions. This is important in our experience. So dynamic assessment is not going to happen in one time. It's persistent sessions the learner acquired through them, the strategy needed. So to overcome the challenge. So it's a continuous work. Periodically, that's why we mentioned periodically, strategically, and methodically. So it's also like any other assessment, dynamic assessment is measurable. How we can measure this method is through either achievement, pro-achievement, or proficiency assessment, classroom interaction, and also classroom performance and observation. So what is really important to understand when you understand listen about dynamic assessment is the interaction. It actually happens in the mental zone of the learner. The mental zone that represents the challenge. So if there is no challenge, which we'd say challenge, that means he is handling a task that beyond his ability, a little bit. It's not that far beyond his ability. So it's a technique, it's a mechanism. That's why we train people on it. So what we call zone of proximal development, and this is exactly what Vygotsky says in his initial method. And this is what Vygotsky says, and we were going on the same road. So
Yeah, I just like to emphasize how we adopted the whole ideas of Vygotsky on our context here at GLOI. And I think we are lucky because it's very easy to get the criteria. We have ILR that can really measure the ability accurately if we use the low, medium, high, for example. So the main point I wanted to make here is that, which is very important because it reflects on the way that a GA certification course is taught here at GLOI. It's supposed to be, the ZPD is supposed to be a little bit higher than the actual ability. So it's very important to put this example that if the student at, let's say, level one, then his ZPG is not two, as they suggest in GA certification. It's actually one plus. And that's very important because we are using the abilities of the students during the mediation to help him reach the abilities that he doesn't know. That's why it needs techniques and strategies, and they are taught in the workshop. This is just another illustration, the ZAG and the ZPG. ZAG is the actual now, we can get it from the ICPG, for example, or we can administer ourselves. And then the ZPG is the level right after. And of course, the objective in the future is to turn the ZPG to ZAG. In other words, the abilities that we couldn't reach, now with the mediation, he managed to. So it's that's why it's dynamic, and the future is to make him independent through mediation and conveying the transformative knowledge, really. During that time, he can develop learning strategies. That's what we have to do.
So, yeah,
when
we talk about how we just kind of cover some of them, it's you have to have a student, either one-on-one, we're going to talk in another slide, I don't want to go further, but it's through the mediation and interaction with all these strategies given to the student, and this mediation should be sensitive to the actual level of performance of the student, and also supposedly to be sensitive to the material that you select and you give to the student. It's all one thing. So it's going through assess, so you assess first, you're not starting with just giving the task, and it's not depend on right or wrong, it's about assessing. You assess the ability of the student, what he can do at this level, and then diagnose his problem, so you highlight it, and this is all for you. Why? Because you need to mediate, so you need to have some idea where you're going with this. You take the assessment, and also you diagnose, you know the problem, then I will go and mediate. I'm not teach or instruct, I'm not giving answer, I'm just mediate, because I need to work on the cognitive ability of the student. I don't want to give him that question, the answer. So, and then I'll come reassess again. So then with assessment, it's again the same thing. Second, you mediate, and then you assign again and reassess by posing the same task challenge again to the student. So you will see the difference. In the same session, if you did it properly, you will see the difference and what the student can do and what is still considering a challenge for him. So you need to go back and adjust again. So the assess, teach, assess is now applied. This is really important about why we talk about dynamic assessment.
And again, we like you to take a couple of seconds to think about this. What comes to mind when those words are mentioned? So my question to you, again, for reflection, How many ways can we accelerate the brain's ability, advance cognitive ability, especially now that we're talking about at-risk students, right? So there are three ways. The first one, of course, is the traditional learning, even if it is learner-centered, the classroom learning. And the second, I thought it would be interesting to share it with you, the use of technology. And that's TNT program. I find it to be extremely interesting. And I thought DLI could have a part of it. We are the largest institute in the world, actually. And I'm surprised we are not. However, the point, of course, is that there are some attempts to induce change in the brain to accelerate the ability to learn. And I find it to be extremely interesting. And if you like, again, you can just Google TNT DARPA and you get it. Or you can just get the link from the presentation. I'm saying that because the third way, as again we see it, this is our perspective, is dynamic assessment. One-on-one. So that's another reason we wanted to fulfill a gap in DA certification course. We believe that it focuses only on diagnostics, and it has nothing to do really with the trainers. It's just historically at DLI, that's how they deliver it. And we find two gaps. One of them is that it focuses only on diagnostic. It doesn't offer any strategies for remedy. And they also misinterpretation of the ZPD, like I mentioned earlier, and the mediation. So we tried with dynamic assessment to fulfill this gap or flow. And also to fulfill the need for a well-defined intervention strategy. Like we said, we started to help the students at level 2 to reach 2 plus and 3, and we have a lot of documented case studies over 3 years, and we had also almost five action research on this topic just to prove the effectiveness. So what did we do? We started the training.
So there is what prompted the need for systematic mentorship program, that's how we see it, is there is increasing rate of attrition rate within the student in the Arabic course, which is one of the most difficult CAT 4 language at DLI. Also, there is absence of early intervention strategy. Why we say this? Because we think there is a need whenever you track there is a falling in the grade of the students. The early on you intervene is to apply an intervention, effective intervention at the moment. So when the student comes, that's proved for when we work with students. If the student came late, so either he's in probation and you don't have that time to work with him so closely, even though if you work with your at best capacity. But it needs time since you identify the failure, so just intervene. Use this right, the right methodology that we offer right now with at-risk students. So then we offer dynamic assessment workshop to create cadre of mentors capable of doing this job. So what we do in this 40 hours training, I'm not going to say all these details, but there is 4 skills every trainee take with them when they finish the workshop. So they actually have to, and those 4 skills sensitive to the dynamic assessment, to conduct dynamic assessment, text typology, proficiency assessment, conducting dynamic assessment sessions, the portfolio interpretation, the early, what Ustaz Hosni talks about is the portfolio reading. It's everybody knows the portfolio, but how to interpret this portfolio components to the student themselves, because there is a lot of people don't know anything about themselves. So, and we find that. You have to make them aware of, reach a little of awareness, allowing them to try to have some strategies for themselves. So text typology, they have to have an ability to select and rate texts in order to give to the students. I also, they need to have the ability to assess their student when they give them this kind of text. So where, what is my student's DAD or DPD? Then conducting dynamic assessment sessions, which is the crux of the all these kind of things we're talking about, is how to conduct an assessment periodically, and also including the mediation techniques and use the strategies needed at the moment you need it. This is participants also, they have some requirement in order to be fully skilled and fully able to conduct the dynamic assessment. They have to choose and work with the student, show us their work, use them as a case study, and also they have to document some testimonies and further evidence of its effectiveness. So, also we did an actual research with our mentors, and we investigated the degree of effectiveness, how they see this effective for them, not for the student, as a trainer, or as a mentor or mediator. So we attempted to evaluate, assess the program, and share the finding. And we did this in a previous action research. We don't have to show, we don't have time to show the... So these are some data we would like to share with you that we are communicating with our mediator and take from them whether they are able and willing to do this. So there is, by now we have 57 at minus 20, they left the school, unfortunately. Number of faculty who participated in the survey, 20, and there is number of willing to practice this job with their students in the school, 18 out of the 20. Two of them, they have their, one of them team leader, they're not just don't want to participate, they have their own reason at that time. Breaking down the language, there is people from the Levantine, Egyptian, and the MSA course. All departments, they have representatives. And also, certified diagnostic assessment were included on this workshop. 9 of them are certified diagnostic. They took the diagnostic assessment course, the big one. So non-certified diagnostic were 9, and capable and skilled were 20. The response of the trainee on the survey proved that dynamic assessment is an effective methodology that were received by the student. Also, that, but there is, anything has challenges and limitations, of course. We're not going to say everything went fine with them. So they claim some challenges based on the survey. So challenges are, it's, for example, it is time consuming, and we agree, time consuming. But look, there is some of them says it is time consuming because to meet its purpose. So they need to work on the purpose so they don't have to hurry. It
has to be periodic.
And also, yes, that has to be periodic. Shortage of teacher, and this is basically from our colleague in the Levantine department, and we know at that time they were so short staffed, and that's why they said they're short in teachers. Now we just really wanted to rush, come to the core, which is the outcome and the finishing.
Like I mentioned earlier, that even though we're talking about a program that we tried and we shared the experience, but really our main objective is to introduce you dynamic assessment. And we hope that we can persuade you. We believe that we succeed in developing a novel methodology. We may have added some contribution. The book that we saw of Lantoff and Bonner, really, it's more about researches. But to use it as a teaching methodology periodically is something new that we came up with. And that's our contribution, really. So we have tried to attempt it strategically within our capacity. I supervise SLS specialists, so I managed to make all the students take all the 5 diagnostic forms when they first come to GLI in the first week in SLS. So every student have it in his computer. That needed that we have to train also teachers to be able to interpret. So it's not only DA specialist who can interpret this or who have this kind of skill. Because we found it actually later that this is one very important part of portfolio reading is one of the most popular. We also developed an e-form to further organize the work. It was an idea that started with Ustaz Mahasin and we developed it. And I hope that we can...
I just wanted to add something about the e-form. The e-form is really what monitoring, how you monitor and track this progress of the certain students when you transfer it to the other teacher. You're not going to write a report, you're just going to write your strategies. Can you find it? Yeah. Anyways, we can share this. We're going to put it in Sakai. Everybody want to see it. It's full, filled with information. You see how you're going to fill this form.
It also should allow...
please keep quiet, please.
It should allow the mentor or mediator, the teacher, to be able to follow up with the student. Three-year experience as both trainers of the method and practitioner of the method, we proved that it has been effective, successful, especially in the case study cases and within our capacity. Sometimes we work with the student and all of a sudden he stopped. And this is, by the way, part of the challenges that we have. So we have the new template, okay, another outcome, and I think this is quite significant. Okay, we'll wrap it up very quickly, but this is really very important because this is one of the outcomes that we came up with a new template. We suggest that it can replace the 4-year-old faculty development or ICC template. And again, we tried to apply dynamic assessment concept, especially assist teacher assist. We did it really successfully. Ms. Tara Shendel tried it in the French department, and Ms. Mahasin Ahmed also tried it in the MSA. And I hope I can show you. Okay, yeah. Very good. Good. Yeah. So I just wanted to show you that. We managed to put it in UCAD, and we have Ms. Schindler that really will have all the credit for putting in UCAD that way. One thing I wanted to say is that I just wanted to show you, we still use the brainstorming as usual. We keep this feature. And the idea here is how to you start with assessing, so you ask the student to write the answer before you know that the question is his GPG. It's a challenge for the student. And yet you ask him to write the answer so that later on, in number 6, you see it here, you can even measure because later on after the mediation, after introducing all the components, lexical, structure, and social, sociolinguistic, then you ask him again, and that's one very good way to measure learning in this way. And it also lends itself to be self-study.
Yeah. Thank you so much, guys.
By the way, I just wanted to say, because this is very important, we managed to develop a curriculum for high level for department A. And I believe our dean attended and she was very happy with the result.
Yeah, this topic is really, we can talk about it the whole day. So, and we have a lot of things to say. We're going to put all the information in Sakai. The slides are very self-explanatory. And if you guys have anything, our emails in the end of the work, the end of the slides. And we are happy to hear from you guys, any comments, any suggestions. We still need to learn from each other. So this is just an idea.
The evaluation sheet.